Hi there, Anthony.
Hello.
How are you doing?
Pretty good. Are you our tech person?
I'm the conference committee person that will at least get this thing rolling here. I think we have a facilitator too. Let me double check.
Okay.
Nope, that's me too.
Okay. Yeah, the only thing we wanted, so we will have breakout rooms at a specific time, and I know you're going to be like you have to do that. We
Awesome.
said we came up, we agreed that like for every five people, we'd like one breakout room. So like,
Okay.
there's only 10 people, we're only going to do two breakout rooms. But if we have at least 20 people, we'll do four. Yeah, with each of us in a different one.
All right. So with each of you in a different room, okay.
Ideally, we'd have at least 20 people for four breakout rooms. But if that doesn't happen, then we'll shorten it.
Right. Can I practice your names? So it's
Sure.
can you pronounce your name, Anthony?
Tadaldi.
Tadaldi. All right, Anthony Tadaldi.
Yep.
And by the way, I'm Chris Koutros.
Hello.
Hello.
And can the rest of you introduce yourself just so I can get the pronunciations right?
Yeah, I'm Samantha Ramaswamy.
So Samantha Ramaswamy, okay.
Yep.
You always say that slowly.
And
Ramaswamy.
I'm Crystal Moose.
Crystal Moose, okay.
And I'm Greg.
Greg Rushton. Right. So I'm making you all co-host. If any, so I'm going to run the breakout rooms, unless one of you wants the power, I'll give you the host.
Yeah, Sam and Crystal like to do the breakout room sessions. I'm also happy to help.
I think that they were nodding no, so.
Oh, wait, what? Yeah.
I've never
Chris, do you
done a
have,
Zoom breakout.
Zoom, do you have any, or Chris, do you have any sense of how many people might be at this thing?
I don't know, but I know that the AP stuff has been very interesting. Jamie Benaiah signed up this morning, so I think he's probably coming.
Yeah. Great.
Literally, I got an email
Probably won't
from
come to
him.
this because he comes to a lot of our stuff.
Yep. I'm
Oh, great.
looking forward to it. I teach AP Chem.
Oh,
It's a
great.
constant struggle. I signed up for AP Teach this summer, so I
Oh,
haven't actually
great.
done anything.
Great.
Oh, yeah,
But so,
come.
like, literally, you are introducing me to it because all I've heard is like third-hand information by a game of telephone.
Oh, great. Yeah.
I got like three emails.
Oh,
That's
that's good.
it. Nice.
And Aaron, are you a teacher? Is Aaron a teacher too?
Yes, I teach in Rhode Island, so and I've taught AP Chemistry, I think now for I don't know 6, 7 years. I taught under I've done like the big revision, like I taught under the previous curriculum, and then the big revision to the big ideas, and then the mini revision to the 9 units. So that's where I don't know, probably too long.
Oh, got. Do you have any sort of files or presentations that you want me to put in the Google Drive folder?
Yes.
Okay.
I'll put our slides in the chat right now. So here are our slides.
All right, good. I'm sorry, I'm getting a call from my conference attend person, so I'll be back.
Oh, wait, what happened to my video? Oh. Did you turn off my video? Don't do that. We are in a professional.
Host. Greg is the host again. Can we just
I was
point that out?
like, Sam, are you okay? Like, why is your video off?
I was anxious about doing it to Crystal because I don't think she has the
I
emotional
won't be able to
stability.
come back on right now.
Yeah.
I love you guys. Being
Oh, that's the
here with you
worst.
guys while I'm getting paid to actually work is awesome.
Was awful. I'm assuming that was Sam, not Anthony, right?
I didn't do that.
Oh, did you do anything? That's awesome.
It was payback for last night.
Okay, so who's sharing? Who's going to do the slide deck?
I'm going to share right now. Desktop. And...
All right. I'm sorry about that. Just
That's okay. It's okay. They were just messing with the video. Sorry about that, Chris.
Okay.
Now, if I present, do you see videos on the right-hand side or no?
I just see videos
right now.
I see videos, but you don't. Cool.
Right.
You just tell me when.
Maybe if you share your whole screen instead of just the application window.
I shared my whole screen, yeah.
Hey, okay. Anthony, do we, or Sam, do we have the link to the breakout rooms?
Yeah, they're on the breakout room slide.
Yep. Okay.
Great. Oh, they're just going to click on it.
Yeah.
We talked about that.
Okay.
All right. So should we start our little intro thing or wait a couple minutes?
I think 1:15 is our official start. We have a few more minutes. You guys are so efficient that, you know, we just have time to kill.
Yeah, we do this all the time.
Yeah.
We can have a pre-chat.
This morning, people tended to, like, have a little time to come in. So, I mean, we started right away. And then, like, I'd say only about 25% of the people started after the official start.
Mm-hmm.
It was a really good talk this morning. We had Dr. Emmanuel from MIT talk about climate change. I actually learned a few things. Like, he had some interesting graphs up. He's like, oh yeah, if we stop polluting carbon dioxide right now, like turn it all off, it would never come down to pre-industrial levels or even like the same level for thousands of years.
So we're screwed regardless, is what you're saying.
Yeah, pretty much. He's like, yeah, you're going to have a 20% drop in CO2 levels just from the peak, but it's not even going to go below 400 parts per million for thousands of years.
So you're saying that me buying a Tesla is not going to do what I expected to do? Because I was hoping that would kind of get us over the hump there, Chris.
His plug was buy some fission reactors from South Korea.
Okay. All right.
Also renewables, they help.
Hey, Susan Biggs is on. We love her.
Susan Biggs. That's good stuff.
Is that a background, Susan, or is that your actual classroom?
It's a picture of my actual classroom. So I'm obviously not there. See, I can go away from it.
Whoa!
Yeah, I'm your secret stalker.
Great, we love it.
I have a question. I read up on your teach thing and I didn't ever find a time yet to ask it, so maybe I should ask it later, but you don't have to answer it now, or maybe you're going to in the talk. I read enough to figure out that this started as a grant, what, 2 or 3 years ago? Somebody studying how to get teachers to be collegial, what happens when the money runs out this year? Who's going to be Amanda and organize everything?
Wow, you're giving us the easy questions at the beginning. Thanks, Susan.
I'm just curious, not because I'm offering. I'm just saying. I just know much about the whole grant and how it happened. And
I don't know. Yeah, I've got a minute. I can give you the minute version, the elevator speech. So Dave Yeren and I wrote this grant in about 2016, 2017. Took a couple years to get funded. And the goal was to scale it so that it would be large enough and self-sustaining in 3 years, that after the grant funds ran out, that you would have enough value and enough people participating to where we wouldn't need grant funds anymore. Now, we do think that there's going to have to be probably some administrative or technical support. And so we're going to probably in this year look for sponsors, possibly College Board, possibly like an AP vendor, you know, like Flynn or something, someone that would support AP chemistry from the outside to see if they would to do that. We've also thought about writing another grant to study, you know, other aspects of it, for example, the social contagion of things. So that's
Thanks. That's a good elevator.
The 45 seconds. Yeah, sure. Thank you, Anthony.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you, Kristen, for telling us about your teaching situation. If the rest of you guys could share with us a little bit about your teaching context and how long you've been teaching, what teaching might look like for you this fall. We'd like to kind of understand the folks we're talking to so that we can tailor the discussion to meet your needs. And we've met Linda before, and we know Susan a little bit. And Chris, thank you. But Brendan and Rowena, Aaron, did you? Newcastle. Oh, okay, Newcastle, yeah, great.
More PA people, yes.
Wow.
Good. All right. So do you want us to start, Chris?
Yeah, I'll do some introductions here.
Okay, sure.
All right, so first of all, welcome to the AP Teach session here at the NEACT Summer Conference. We're really happy that you can be here. It looks like a great presentation, so I've got some introductions here. Greg Rushton is a professor of chemistry and the director of the Tennessee STEM Ed Center at MTSU. He holds an undergraduate degree in chemistry from USC and graduate degrees in science education and physical organic chemistry from the other USC, University of South Carolina. He taught college prep, honors, and AP at the high school level and advanced courses at university level since 1995. Hope I didn't go too fast. Samantha Ramaswani is the AP chemistry teacher at Penn Trafford High School in a suburb of Pittsburgh, where she's also the sponsor to the Science National Honor Society. She taught every level of chemistry from academic up through AP, and she earned her bachelor's degree in chemistry from Purdue and then her master's in science education from Montana State University. Outside of the classroom, she's the president-elect of the Pennsylvania Science Teachers Association, I guess a NEACT cousin, where she's working to create a more collaborative network of science teachers. Anthony Tadaldi earned his master's in chemistry at St. John's University in Queens, New York. In June of 2014, Anthony was awarded the Woodrow Wilson Teaching Fellowship and entered the secondary Masters of Arts and Certification Program for Education at the University of Michigan. Upon completion of this program, he accepted a full-time chemistry teacher position at Bellevue High School in Bellevue, Michigan, where he's taught conceptual and honors chemistry, organic chemistry, and AP chemistry. In his first year, he was awarded the NALS Teacher Initiative Fellowship. And outside the classroom, he's the advisor for the Gay Straight Alliance, class advisor for the class of 2023. I'm 2021 at my school. And a member of the school's PBIS team, very important, and a member of the Van Buren Public Schools Educational Foundation. Crystal Moose teaches AP chemistry and honors chemistry at Midway High School in Waco, Texas. She works beside colleagues in a one-to-one technology setting where the entire framework of chemistry has been redesigned to immerse students in a rigorous course that brings everyday chemistry phenomena to life. Having earned a bachelor's of biology at Hardwick College, the major focus has been driving inquiry instruction in the laboratory setting for students to enjoy and understand the connection between labs and chemistry content. She's previously taught honors bio, AP bio, integrated physics and chem, and research and design. Outside the classroom, she sponsored students attending the International Science Fair and coaches science academic UIL team. So I think we're all really appreciative that all of you are spending your time and sharing all your knowledge with us. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for spending a little bit of time with us. Okay, so I'm gonna introduce the community to you guys, and then I'll hand it over to some of our users to talk through the experience and to answer questions. So as I was talking about with Susan at the beginning of the session, AP Teach is an Department of Education funded research project from 2018 to 2021. We launched our website formally and our community website, formally in the spring, right at the beginning of COVID and the shutdown. And the goal of the project is to figure out ways to professionalize teaching and to support each other professionally while we're teaching hard things like AP chemistry. So kind of the broader goal is to get folks to interact with each other virtually in an ongoing format so that whenever we're in a difficult spot, whether it's tomorrow or next week or today, we have the support both kind of psychologically and socially to help each other stay motivated and to improve our practice. So having been a long time AP chemistry teacher myself, I felt like I was isolated. I skipped the things that I didn't really understand, or that if there were questions about, I didn't think I could answer. And I didn't feel good about that, but it was the best that I knew how to do at the time. And I just didn't want to have that be the experience for lots of other AP chemistry teachers. So the goal is to get you guys connected and to feel like you're supported and you can do great things with your kids. And over time, the kind of normative or typical experience for someone in AP chemistry class is to experience really high level, high quality instruction, to have a really good experience, to do well on the AP exam, and to look forward to taking more chemistry courses in the future. So that's kind of the idealistic pie in the sky goal of the project. We're at about between 800 and 1,000 teachers that we've worked with so far in the first several months. The other folks on this call with me have been a part of it and have gotten excited about it. Linda and Susan, we've seen you guys several times on some of our things. So do you want to go to slide 2, whoever's running it? And we'll, okay, so there's several different ways you can kind of experience AP Teach. Kind of the probably most high profile is Thursday nights from 8 to 9 Eastern, or 7 to 8 Central. We try to pick a topic that we're all thinking about as a community and have some folks lead discussions around that topic that have thought about it a little bit to try to give some ideas for how to improve the quality of our experience as teachers. And then we break up into smaller groups to talk about it kind of more at length. And then we debrief, and then we think about what else we can be talking about. And then between those sessions, between the virtual conference kind of sessions, virtual workshop sessions, we interact with each other asynchronously and synchronously through social media. And so what else am I supposed to say?
That was good. I got it from here.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, great. Thanks.
So this is Anthony again. Thank you. As Greg mentioned, you get into small groups, and we will practice that again, or we'll see it today. We have breakout rooms, we call them. And that's because sometimes we have a lot of teachers who join the session, and it would be almost impossible for equal voices to be heard unless we were in these breakout rooms. And these breakout rooms have kind of questions for us to kind of discuss and take notes on. And so here's an example of from that session that you saw, and the example of the question for the AP reader: how has teaching changed since you've been a reader? And so you have a facilitator who will ask the question. We usually ask one person to record notes, and then each of us kind of just discuss, and the one person recording notes can participate, or they are recording for us. And then usually, sometimes we have like a choose your own adventure breakout room in which you could choose which one you want to go to. If there's one that is a little bit more exciting to you, like we just had last week, where teachers chose which one they wanted to go to. If you're concerned about which one to choose from, we always record them. So every breakout room is recorded and it's posted on our AP Teach website that we'll talk about later. And then through these discussions, either from the facilitators of the breakout rooms or from the participants, we have folders that come from each session. And in each session, there are either resources provided by facilitators, or the participants are like, oh, I know this cool website, or I have this cool document, or I have this cool slide deck, or so on and so forth. And we compile them and put them into their each respective folder. So as you can see, all of our folders are labeled by every date that we met. And this happens every time we meet. We have a folder for every meeting with AP Teach. And you could easily find like, oh, that was that one cool session in February 20th about mentoring. Let me see what was in there. Or there was that cool session about review strategies. Let me check out in there too. Crystal is actually gonna guide us now into our breakout rooms for today.
So probably my favorite thing by far is the breakout rooms. We exist in a school that provides PLCs, but I'm also very isolated in that because I don't really have anybody else to meet with as far as my actual curriculum. And so like Greg was saying, I would get to the point where I needed some ideas or needed to get motivated and didn't really have anybody to turn to. And so we're going to go into these breakout rooms. And right now we're facing absolutely insane times. And I know I am already back in my classroom planning. We are going back face-to-face with an asynchronous virtual model. And I'm really having to think about what I'm doing with my students and be creative. And so what we're going to do is we're going to get into these breakout rooms. We're probably just going to go into two different breakout rooms and share how we used to start the beginning of the year. You know, if it's a perfect scenario, what are some of the activities you do or did at the beginning of the year to help, you know, inspire us? And then how can you take those activities and move them into social distancing or virtual learning settings? When you do go into the breakout rooms, we're going to ask that you contribute, that you're positive, and that you take away from it what you put in. And so when you walk out of there, we hope to inspire you about rethink your beginning of the year activities so we can get our kids hooked into chemistry early.
Can I just say, so at NEACT, we're trying to get people to take notes of the of their time in the breakout rooms. Yep. And so you have the slide for that. So that takes care of that. So I don't have to do anything. So I've got everybody in two rooms, so I'll open them up.
And Chris, could you put like me and one of the other presenters in one room and make sure that yep. the other two in the other to help lead the conversation?
I have Crystal and Anthony in one room, and I have Greg and Samantha in the other room.
Great. Thank you so much.
All right.
And so we're going to talk for maybe 20 minutes or so, right? 15, 20 minutes. And then Chris, will you bring us back when we're done? Okay, great. Thank you so much.
I'll stop sharing. Ooh, break up.
So Morgan, what are you gonna do if we can't send things home to kids and we've gotta be hybrid or remote and we've gotta still teach labs and—
It's a
tricky situation, right?
It is. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
I'm testing new equipment. My school laptop's getting the hard drive wiped because it is a little— to answer your question is, I'm planning, so I live in New Britain, Connecticut, and those teachers are essentially teaching remotely, even though it's a hybrid plan. And I think they're going to be essentially teaching remote in the classroom. And at the moment, that's my plan, what I'm going to do at Berlin also, unless my administrators have other ideas. And I see it kind of being kind of like a flipped classroom where the kids are watching, you know, getting the instruction off of things that currently exist. And then while they're in class with me, I'll be able to pop in and give them the support that they need. And then I'm looking for things to make it not— it was, you know, the spring was pretty— it was boring. It's boring. And so, trying to figure out ways to engage kids and, you know, and hoping to use a lot more online tools than we have in the past.
Yeah, and for me, boring is stressful because then you have behavior issues, you have people that are unmotivated.
I got my kids for 3 hours for two double blocks twice a week.
Gosh.
And then regular 1 hour classes. In a normal scenario, I love it, but that's a lot of online sitting and figuring.
That's awful.
Thanks.
All right. So thank you guys for coming back. We had a very engaging discussion on our group. And what am I doing? I'm not supposed to talk right now, right, Crystal?
We can do a recap of breakout rooms like we normally do. So go for it, Greg.
Samantha Ramaswamy, you want to give us a summary of our room?
Yeah, so in our room, you know, we kind of started talking about— so we were breakout room two. We kind of just started talking about what our scenarios were going to look like for the year. And then we started shifting kind of more toward the idea of labs. So how are we going to have kids working together, or are we going to? And kind of got into the conversation about liability. So how are we held liable if we send things home for the kids? What about videos? So we kind of started talking about that and talking about, you know, if kids can wash their hands before and after, why can't they share equipment? So we were just kind of talking about more of the lab aspect and how kids can either work together. And if they're in person, that's kind of a bonus. And then anytime they're not in person with us, that can be when we're doing more of the videos and that kind of asynchronous work.
Mm-hmm. What was it like?
Actually, we talked about something really similar and went into the lab stuff. So we kind of shared Brendan kind of shared the Johnstone triangle idea that you go from macroscopic to microscopic to symbolic, the math calculations. And so a lot of the demos we do just start to bridge that gap so that students are thinking about things in more in-depth ways. And then we started talking about labs as well. And one of the things that was shared is that Flynn's recommending 15 minutes and greater than 70% isopropyl alcohol and then a UV cabinet for goggles in between uses. And so that was completely new to me, and I'm about to go into a meeting with my supervisors. So thank you so much for sharing that. But similar discussions, just lab topics and, you know, how can we work around that in a positive way? So one of the things Brendan brought up was a solution was to have the students work by themselves. And then Linda said, maybe you could do a micro scale where you're not having to worry about sanitizing the equipment, because it's not just the goggles. You're also supposed to sanitize the actual, you know, crucible tongs for 15 minutes as well. So Linda suggested setting up like micro scale labs that is just disposable. And so you just one per group and it's all done and you throw it away at the end. So that was a really helpful spin to get things in a positive direction. So it was a great conversation.
Yeah, great.
Anthony, did you want to add anything else?
Nope. Anthony's speechless for the first time. Okay, so Crystal, what happens next?
Question is, the question that we sometimes forget to say is like, how do you actually join AP Teach? It is free. It just, well, maybe not free because it requires you to think, and that's like brain power and time. But if you go to apteach.org, this is an image of a screenshot of our website. And so you can actually join the website. So you hit join site and then you'll log in some of your information. From there, you can see some of the live discussions that we've already participated in, as well as joining Slack. So really there's the synchronous version of let's meet via a Zoom and have these wonderful conversations like what you just experienced. But then there's also an asynchronous approach to it. So when you leave here, I know that I'm going to walk away inspired to find something else to do with my students the first couple of days. I may want to post some of my ideas or crowdsource using Slack. And so Sam's going to talk about what Slack is and how we use it within APTeach.
Okay, so like Crystal said, you know, we have these synchronous in-person virtual discussions where we have these breakout rooms, and sometimes you want the conversations to continue. So 15 or 20 minutes just isn't enough time. So APTeach has a Slack workspace. So once you sign up for APTeach on the website, you'll get kind of the welcome to APTeach email. And in that email, it will tell you how to join Slack. And so Slack is a place that we can have these asynchronous discussions. So I could send a message to one of the channels at, you know, 9 a.m. and then maybe Greg doesn't see it until 2 p.m., but then he can respond. And so it's a place that we can continue the discussions. And this is just a screenshot of Anthony's Slack. And so you can see that on the left-hand side, we have all of these different channels. So there might be something from this Moving AP Chem Online channel where we're talking about how can we shift our instruction from in-person to online. And I believe that we also had a channel created that's, it's NEACT is what the channel's called, correct, Crystal? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you can actually, once you join Slack, if you click on this plus, you can actually search all of the different channels and you can actually search for NEACT and continue conversations there. We also have channels for Unit 1, Unit 2. I mean, there are way more channels than I even knew until I clicked that plus sign. But there are a lot of conversations happening in the Unit 1 channel about how we can teach different topics within Unit 1 of the AP curriculum. I know Crystal had sent some questions in there and like Michael Farabaugh responded. I had created a PES card sort for our last AP Teach session and I put that into the Unit 1 channel. And so it's just a place that we can ask questions, we can collaborate, we can post resources. So if you had an activity that worked really well with your students, you can put it in there. And you can then share that with everybody that's part of the channel. So it's just a place that we can continue the collaboration, but kind of on our own time.
And I just want to differentiate this from like Twitter and Facebook in that you know, we did quite a bit of analysis of those kinds of discussions when it's public, totally public, and there tends to be different norms in different communities about how to interact. And we just found that they tend to be pretty informational rather than relational. And we really want APTeach to be a place where we build relationships between other teachers. We can ask the hard questions. We can be vulnerable and say, I didn't understand this, or this kid asked this question, or I didn't know what to do here, or I don't know how to plan this. I gave it my best shot today and no one got it. That kind of stuff, which happens for me more often than I'd like to admit in AP chemistry. And we want this to be like a, almost like a small group of people that you can trust, that you can work with to get better at what you're doing. And we have great people like Susan, who've been doing this for a really long time, Michael Farabaugh. We have like, you know, some of the kind of cultural icons in there that can kind of give us the best, sorry, Susan. No, we have like some of the, you know, kind of the forefathers of the, I don't know if that was any better, I'm sorry. No, we have some of the leaders, you know, people that, you know, we would take APSIs from and we would see at AP conferences, you know, that are question leaders or table leaders. And we can kind of get the best ideas that we have in the community, you know, brought right into our own classroom. So it's meant to be something different than what exists presently in other venues.
So I had Anthony go back a slide because while I was talking, I forgot to mention the other cool piece that started before these online discussions became really big due to, you know, everybody not having to go to school anymore, but I, teach virtually.
Sorry, can I interrupt?
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm alone. I don't see that slide. I see just the start slide.
Oh.
Yeah.
I see welcome to AP Teach on my slide.
Me too.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Never mind. Sorry. I'm sorry for interrupting. I just wanted to clarify.
No. You're totally okay.
That's our website slide. Yeah.
And so what I wanted to tell you was something that I found probably a month and a half into working in this is that when you join the website, what it opens up are resources that uncover misconceptions and help identify them in students and correct them so that they are kind of doing a little bit more with things that we commonly know students do wrong. And so that piece is there as well. We don't usually focus on it as much, but if you're getting to a concept and you're like, I don't really know how to teach that, I don't think I teach it well, I definitely suggest using the resources on the website to help get you started, because I know that I've found some simulations and some activities, some particulate diagram activities done by different teachers that are really amazing.
And the way we built those and the way we'll build them in the future, if you guys want them as a community, is we do a deep dive into the scoring of the last AP exam. And then we try to pull out the things that were the most difficult for students across the board, looking at 100 or 150,000 students. And then we write, you know, curriculum. And then we talk through on short videos, how we're thinking about, you know, addressing those issues. So we looked at like 2015 through 2018, I think, and we built a bunch of videos around the kind of most common issues.
Are we ready for the after party, Greg, where we just get to open it up and chat?
Well, so do we have till 2 or do we have till 2:15?
2:15.
Okay. So yeah, so is that the end of kind of the formal part of the presentation?
Yeah.
The next presenter would be okay with you starting at 2:30 even if you wanted to.
Was
that you, Brendan? Very clever. You definitely belong in our community if you're funny like that all the time. You have to be funny like that all the time though. So questions that I have are, you know, what are things that you need right now as teachers that AP Teach could be thinking about designing, you know, instruction around, discussions around, Slack channels around, or you could tell us what things that you think that you could contribute as AP teachers to a community like this, because I'd like that term that Crystal uses, crowdsourcing. We're trying to crowdsource AP Chem essentially.
Greg, can I talk a little about persistent groups?
Yeah, sure.
So in our last session on Thursday, there was a lot of conversation around how we're going back in a week, 2 weeks, like whenever we go back to school. And so something that we've been talking about in AP Teach is creating these persistent groups. So we've been meeting every 2 weeks over the summer, just because every week was a little much. So we were meeting every 2 weeks. And now that we're getting closer to school, there are some teachers within AP Teach that want to go back to the weekly just because they say this is their place where they can brainstorm, they can discuss. Even if we don't have like a general idea, we have these like happy hours sometimes where we just talk. We just like throw ideas out, see what people think. And so we've had these ideas of creating these persistent groups, which are essentially small groups. So instead of having a Zoom with 150 or 200 people, we have this small group of teachers that maybe there are 10 of us. And so we've been in the works kind of talking about how we can create these persistent groups based on how we're going back in the fall or in a week or 2 weeks. And so if persistent groups are something that you'd be interested in, join the website. So that way you can be on the lookout for an email about, you know, a survey to join one of these persistent groups. And I think if you'd be interested in being kind of the facilitator for one, you know, kind of let's say let Greg know. that, you know, you might be interested in kind of being like a facilitator of one of these persistent groups as well. Because I think what a lot of teachers want, kind of like Crystal said, is, you know, just a small PLC that you have other teachers that are in similar situations as you. So that's also in the works.
Brendan, what were you going to say?
I was going to ask for exactly what Samantha was suggesting there. I know that the email for signing up for Slack is in my email box with 170 other emails. So
yeah,
I will look at it.
Yeah. I think the good thing about this kind of PLC would be it would be an opt-in. So if you're not going to participate regularly, you know, you won't likely be in the group, which means you won't be dead weight for other people, and other people won't be dead weight for you. And having been in a lot of PLCs, I feel like sometimes that's kind of the experience I have. So, you know, this would be for, you know, people that really want to try to make it not like, you know, it sounds like, Morgan, it could be if we don't have the ideas from other people. Because, you know, I feel like even face-to-face, sometimes my class is boring, and I know that online or remote, it's going to be even worse. So, you know, having the ideas from this group is really helpful to me.
I think we've already kind of sifted right here and right now, just the people who are here putting in their time over the summer are the people who are more committed to these PLCs and trying to not just be dead weight and put stuff in and get stuff out for it too. And crowdsourcing is such a brilliant idea if you can find people who are in that same sort of model, whatever your model ends up being.
Yep. So one thing that we could probably use help with, and this is something we've been talking about for the last few days, is how would the persistent groups be designed? Like what would it be designed around? We thought, for example, it'd be the order in which you taught things, so that like when you're planning a particular topic, activity, or, you know, whatever, you're with other people. But it sounds like there also may be some merit in like the format in which you're trying to teach. So whether you're all like asynchronous, or you're all synchronous, or you're hybrid, or something like that, that might be another way to kind of to orient the conversation. Because if I'm teaching the same thing as Sam, but we're in two different formats, we may come up with totally different ways to do it. So, Linda, you have some thoughts on that? You've been in a lot of these conversations.
No, I totally agree with you. I know we had talked about those who follow the CED curriculum in the units versus going kind of chapter-based. But I think for this year in particular, it would make a lot more sense if we're teaching in person to be with other people teaching in person versus completely remote, asynchronous or synchronous. I think that's going to probably gear how we're teaching a lot more. So I don't know if it's useful to have just based on type of format you're using, or kind of a subset of type of format and order, depending how many groups you want to create.
I think it might almost be better if you just go with the format that you're teaching in, whether it's remote, you know, hybrid, mm-hmm. or another version of hybrid. There'd probably be a few kinds of hybrid or mm-hmm. in person. Because if people are teaching in a different order, that's almost to the benefit. You can develop your materials and share within your PLC, and they can be developing those materials for their yeah. units. Instead of you developing 9, you can develop 2 or 3.
Right. That's a good point.
I keep asking for, and I think maybe you guys just say, you're out of bounds. Just stop asking. What I need and would like to hear, or what I enjoy hearing, is how do you, Samantha, say, what do you do when you teach, I don't know, electrolysis? I know what I do. I know it's okay. But every time I hear someone else, I'm like, you know, most of it, it's like, yeah, I get that. Or no, I don't want to do that. Or yeah, I like that. But every now and then I'm like, ooh, I didn't think of saying that little thing. Yeah. And I keep asking for that. And you guys keep wanting to talk about one more, go formative. And I can't listen to any more of those, which is why
good.
I keep doing it for those that need it. And I'll just sort of keep multitasking. But I really enjoy hearing how people say about topics. Then let me figure out what works for me and my kids and my school and my personal technology and all that.
We've been having that same exact conversation, Susan. It's just that, you know, when we're in a group of 8,000 teachers, you know, I don't know how many are more like you and me that have been teaching for 25 years, and I can figure out how to do it. I just need to have the idea of what to do, versus other people are like, I don't know how to do it. I need the Pivot Interactives. I need the Chem Collective. I need the FET simulation. I need to see those things because I need to know how they're done. and then I can figure out, you know, what to do. So I think it's kind of like the APSIs, you know, some people are kind of more at the beginning and they need different kinds of conversations than people that have been doing it for 15 or 20 years. So we're trying to be responsive. It's just, we don't know exactly what everyone needs. So those are the ones you're talking about. That's the conversation I want to have because I can figure out how to do it.
I would argue that in fact, there's a whole lot of beginners that also need to hear how okay. they need to say and things they need to not say, like using Le Chatelier's principle when you're talking about a voltaic cell or
just using Le Chatelier's principle, period.
Well, yeah, but so I don't know. And I'm not trying to steer your group.
Yeah. It's your group, Susan.
No, well, whatever. But, and again, I don't mind the other stuff because I can listen and multitask and I certainly have picked up some tidbits. But I was just wondering if you envision that it will ever go that route too?
Hey, Susan, if I had the unanimous vote, all we would do is nerd out on how we explain things. But I had to kind of just, you know, like part of the conversation the last time was what people were asking for was different than what I wanted to do. And so I will get there with you and with everyone.
Maybe we need to be in one of those mini groups.
Persistent
groups, yeah. Let's learn
this will be my fourth year teaching AP Chem. Yeah. I know that I've really honed in on how to explain things and what to say, but you're right. Those little clicks on exactly what to say, even though it's right by AP, what is the one word I'm saying wrong that drives my students to a misconception in their way over here? And so that is the stuff that I do want to talk about too. So even within the committee, there's people that we have to listen to the multitude, but that would be a great idea, Greg, for a persistent group, people who just don't really need that development in curriculum or in how we're going to deliver instruction more in what's driving the curriculum as far as terminology. And I would join Susan with that.
Yeah. And I think a thing with persistent groups too, is once we have that, the persistent groups, and if we do on how we teach, then the main sessions can go back to, you know, how to explain periodic trends, how to explain, or, you know, things like that, kinetics, acids and bases, thermochem. And then the persistent groups can then be used to hone in on how can we teach that in our scenario. So like, I think once we have those persistent groups as well, then if the main sessions go back to, you know, the big idea topics, you know, each unit idea, I guess, then those persistent groups can then work on developing the actual, you know, how to teach.
And maybe, maybe Greg, people don't like that because they feel like, oh, if I go to some session and I don't want to listen to somebody teach something, it's like, okay, I get that you all get it, but this is what I say, or what I really rather hear is, I get it. And I'm successful teaching it to the kids, but I want to hear how you say it because there's always just one more phrase or one more thing. And if I'm saying that after 19 times through, I don't know, maybe I'm just a weirdo, Crystal.
No, there's other, I feel the same way.
No, one of my favorite things about APSI, I met Rockmed there and he was an experienced teacher attending a bigger teacher or a beginner teacher. And the lady would end session to go to the bathroom and we would keep having the discussion in the room to talk about how we individually specific taught it and we would take turns. And that's what I feel like this does. My school won't approve an APSI right now or probably for the next 3 or 4 years because my scores are enough. And so I can't do that. This allows me to do that and have those discussions. And I love them. I go back, I have like notepads of things that Rockmed told me where, you know, I was kind of wrong. Here's what he says. And then other people's ideas too. And so I really think that, I don't know, what do you call it? Like hallway talk? Is that the terminology?
Yeah, we call it the unconference. Hallway. Yeah, we call it post-workshop.
The unconference. But I love that, Susan. Like, I really think that would be a really neat thing to start back up.
Okay, I'll keep joining in then.
Yeah, please, and keep pushing that. You can join the steering committee and just start that conversation.
Well,
the other thing that I think would be helpful to me is you know, we started in the spring around this conversation of like kitchen sink questions, where like you, in one question, you like connect a lot of different ideas. To me, I like to do that in my teaching. So it's more than just Johnstone's triangle, but it's also like previewing a topic in September and October that we're not going to get to deeply, but we're going to introduce, and they're going to get the language and maybe how to think about it conceptually. And then when I'm teaching another subject, I think back where, you know, it's actually authentic, an authentic way to connect a previous topic or topics. And I see how to do that somewhat. And I think I could use more ideas about how to connect a particular lesson to other things before and after it. And I don't think our textbooks do that very well. And I don't know that I do it as well as I'd like.
I agree.
Anthony, now that you're at your standing desk, did you want to share something?
Just about Bitmojis and how they're so great and thematic and no, all of you are saying great things.
All right. Other comments? We can end early. We don't have a bell, but I hope we'll see you sometime soon. We're trying to figure out whether to do kind of a happy hour or trying to just kind of a more informal thing this Thursday or try to plan something more formal for the following Thursday. So if you do join Slack, you can be part of that conversation about what's needed at what point. So Brendan, nice to meet you, and Aaron and Rowena, Kristen, thank you guys for joining. And
thank you.
Linda, always good to see you. Susan, always glad to have you too. And Chris, thanks for setting this up for us.
Yeah, thank you for coming. It was really informative. I'm really looking forward to participating this year.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Morgan, if you don't mind, I'm gonna hand over hosting to you.
Sure.
You're gonna get all the power. All the power going to Morgan there.
Chris, can I ask you a quick question before we get off?
Yes.
If we recorded our breakout room, is there a place you want us to put that?
I think it's all cloud recording through Zoom. So I think we have access to everything.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah. And if you want, I think you're getting all the same links as everybody else. It's that bit.ly/NEAC2020 links document, and all the recordings will be up there. So you should be able
to. Okay, I just wanted to make sure there wasn't anything I needed to do with.
I don't think so.
Okay.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
So Morgan's gonna be the host for this session. I'm really looking forward to this session, by the way.
Hang on.
Morgan, I don't know if you saw that the Google folder has like Brendan's bio and everything. I'm just gonna post.
I don't know him. It's true. I don't know him.
Oh. Yeah, I figured that you were just meeting for the first time.
Yeah, we're gonna be all right.
Stick to the bio, Morgan. Stick to the bio.
Oh.
I also think we got a few minutes before his thing starts, and that session was really cool. I like that. So Linda, you've been doing AP Teach.
Yeah, I've been going to their sessions probably since March, since we've been remote, and it's an amazing group just because it's so collaborative. So unlike other sessions I've attended during the summer, where it was more like a webinar where you're just listening to someone else speak, it's so much more engaging because they do have the breakout rooms where you go for, you know, 20, 30 minutes in smaller groups. There might be 200 people in the whole session, but in your breakout room, maybe there's 6 or 8, and you can have real meaningful discussions and come out with great resources. The last breakout room, I had Michael Farabal in there, who you know is fantastic. We had the lead reader on the AP exam giving us advice. So the resources are fantastic, and it's just so collaborative and interactive. So you feel like you're, you know, getting to know each other, and everyone brings in different experience.
It's a
great resource.
I know Kristen Vanderveen, the president of NEAC, she loves it, and she was the one pushing me to do it.
Yeah, I've been attending. I mean, I look forward to them. When every 2 weeks they come up, I look forward to what I'm going to learn that night.
So we have maybe one more minute left. Hi, Kristen and Rowena. Rowena, we don't get NEAC in person this time, but it's nice to see you.
Yeah, and, nice to see you. Thank you, Chris.
And Kristen and Aaron. And Anne-Marie, I think, is listening to all of us, but Anne-Marie, if you shoot me an email, I'll shoot you how to dial in by phone so you can talk if you want.
Does anybody know who funds the AP Teach folks? It's a nonprofit, and I was just kind of looking on their website, trying to check them out, and it looks great. It just
I think David Yaron has like a grant, I believe, through his university. That's what
That makes sense.
Because I asked that too, because it's a free participation, free to join, and so I think it's through a grant.
Yeah, great. All right, are people ready to, is it showtime? People, thank you for being here today. My name is Morgan Hanna. I teach at Berlin High School, the AP Environmental Science program. And it's my pleasure to introduce Mr. Wilkosz, who joined our department 15 years ago. And he's a UConn grad, and he really did. He brought our chemistry program into the 21st century. We had a really, really, really strong biology program. And then shortly thereafter, he went to St. Joe's and earned his master's in chemistry, and he did hit the ground rolling. We do the AP program at our high school, and we also offer 6 credits of chemistry through UConn's ECE program, and so very proud to be a part of that and have him lead our department through that the last 15 years. He's also our showman. He does a lot of science club stuff, and the whole school seems to come after school to see him put ping pong balls in a giant trash can and blow it up with liquid nitrogen and things like that. So we got a lot of that going on in Berlin High School, and his kids, they deliver at the on the UConn transcript, and year in and year out, they deliver on the AP program in terms of their scores. And in recent years, he's been consistently going and being an AP reader, which is the purpose of his talk today. So Brendan, thanks for being a part of our department, and here's our crew.
Thank you, Morgan, for the nudge in the right direction to present here today.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Everybody okay? Getting good audio? Just want to make sure, because I have, the tech issues, it's very easy for those things to go south. Let me share my screen with y'all. So we were talking about Bitmojis in the last session, and I threw a couple of them in here just for ha-has. Took a few hours to get used to that here. Thank you, everyone, for checking this out here. This is about AP chemistry reading, and Morgan's going to be collecting questions and stuff. So if you have anything, just drop it in the chat. I'm going to try to keep it informal. So if you are interested in unmuting yourself and just asking a question, don't feel like you're interrupting. I mean, I have a presentation here, but there's time built in, and I want to hear what you have to think about these things. So if you have any interest in becoming an AP reader, my hope and my aim today is to try to give you that last little nudge to do it, because it's so worth it. We'll talk about what the AP chemistry reading is and why on earth you would do that to yourself, because it does make your brain hurt a little bit. So at every professional session, I always try to pick out like one strategy or something that I could use in my own practice. I think Susan Biggs was talking about this before, like how to hone her own practice a little bit better. So I think it helps to have an idea of where I'm coming from, so you can kind of assess the applicability of what I have to say for use in your own classroom, whatever that means in the near future. So there's some contact info here for me, and I teach at Berlin High School, which is a high school of about 900 students when they're in person. It's in Berlin, Connecticut, which is like the geographic center of Connecticut, just south of Hartford. It's a residential and industrial community of about 20,000 people. We do accept students from other local towns. For our AP chemistry program, it's actually AP chemistry and UConn ECE dual enrollment. It's 8 credits worth of like intro first semester and second semester chemistry. We get between 20 and 40 students annually enrolled there. So that's kind of where I'm coming from. Like I said, unmute yourself at any point, pop in, ask questions. I do want to thank Morgan Hanna for facilitating the session and gathering the questions. It's very much appreciated. But don't feel like you can, you know, you can unmute yourself and participate. I don't have plans to make breakout rooms or anything, but just drop in with a question, or if I'm saying something that doesn't make sense or you want more information about, let me know. I also want to thank Jerusha, Kristen V, and Chris for the nudge to present about this topic and the encouragement here, and let me know that it might be valuable for people to get a little push into seeing what this this setup is like. So it is a beautiful kind of torture. I hope by the end of this, you get an understanding of what it's like to read in person, a little bit about what it's like to read in a distance format that was on the computers this last summer here, or just now. It feels like 4 years ago, but it was like a month ago. And I'm also gonna weave in some tips and kind of leave you with a bunch of tips of what you can do to help your AP Chem students express their ideas more succinctly and clearly on the exam, and to trick the readers into giving them points. And, or demonstrate the chemistry that they know, one of the two. I am personally not a fan of grading like big piles of labs or, you know, stacks of tests or gigabytes of images as I had to do for the reading here. And I understand anyone's hesitancy in becoming involved in this reading because it is a beautiful kind of torture. But I hope that by the end of this, you'll get some peace of mind and some understanding of how at least I stopped like worrying about the responsibility that was on me when I was doing the grading and learned to love that AP exam reading experience. So I started reading in 2016, and I wasn't sure if I would be able to do it. They sent out invitations in January and February of a given year, and the people are invited then to start their reading, and they do it the subsequent June. I started teaching AP Chem way back in 2008, and it was just AP Chem. I was only able to get it off the ground as dual enrollment a few years later with some more college classes and stuff. I first filed to become an AP reader in 2014 after I attended a conference, and the folks who were running were like, you know, at some point you should be doing this. You got to see what it's like. And I was like, you want me to do what for 52 hours in a row straight, just sit in a room and grade? I wasn't sure I would be able to do it, especially in 2016 when my first invite came. Throughout the whole session in 2016, I actually had like stacks of different flight schedules for a few different airlines, because at that point, my wife, Victoria, in addition to caring for our two-year-old son who's there watching the planes leave in 2016, she was also 8.5 months pregnant in Connecticut when I was gallivanting off in Utah. So there's challenges to it. I mean, 7 consecutive days of 7.5 hours of grading sounds torturous, and it is in some respects, and it's really 9 days away from your family because of travel under normal circumstances. But the readers always feel an immense responsibility to do a good job because they kind of understand what goes into getting a student from where they started to moving to being a student who is willing to sit and take an AP test, whether it's digitally or in person. They know how much work a teacher has to put in to get students ready for the AP Chem. They know how hard the instructors work. They know how hard the students work, and even just to, you know, learn the ideas and then review for it. The readers don't take the responsibility lightly. It's a lot of work. The scope of the task is kind of mind-boggling. Hundreds and thousands of tests. It's a lot. And at least in 2016, there were those 7 questions for the free response that had either 4 or 10 points. So there's like thousands and thousands of points being assessed on this. It's mind-boggling, and it's a challenge to kind of wrap your brain around being ready to do that. Before you get like kind of swallowed up by what it's like to grade and how many things have to get done, you have to actually just get there, and that's done through a third-party, helper, a third-party company called Concur. They held the reading in 2016 in Salt Lake City, and they used the Salt Palace Convention Center as the place where people go and grade. Concur is pretty good. It's pretty straightforward for you to get a flight, but you'd have to shop around a little bit. It takes an hour or two to get your flight under a threshold so that you don't have to pay for it yourself. You end up rooming with one person unless you want to pay for your rooming, and it's not so bad. You also want to make sure when you're working through Concur that you can like make sure your flights are timed well and you have enough time to get, like, I was sprinting across the Detroit airport, Detroit Fort Worth or whatever the airport was there to get from point A to point B because of the way that the system worked out. But you get all these weary travelers and they have their first meeting that first morning, of the thing, and you get like this rah-rah speech to make sure you're fair, accurate, consistent, and efficient. Fair, accurate, consistent, efficient. Doesn't matter where you came from, what your background is. All these people are college professors or AP teachers in high school, and they know what goes into a student getting to the point where they're ready to take the test. And so they appreciate, like, you have to be fair, accurate, consistent, efficient, even if you are weary and tired. If I can give you one piece of advice about this, it is to wear comfortable shoes. These pictures don't do justice to the scope of this space here, but the Salt Palace is gigantic. What you're seeing in the picture, the left picture there, those three banks of doorways, is the entrance, the south entrance to a what's called the Grand Ballroom. It is a 45,000 square foot room that's like subdivided for different parties that you go to. And then kind of in that left picture, kind of up on the left, there's like some stairs on the very edge of that. I don't know if my cursor can show you, but there's some stairs up there. And they get you up to the meeting rooms, and those themselves are 8,800 square feet, those meeting rooms. You have all your whole group meetings in the meeting rooms down in here, and you have all your other ones upstairs. Wear comfortable shoes. To me, it was a little perplexing in the beginning. Like, everyone was so, like, sugar sweet friendly, and maybe, you know, puritanical East Coast thing, you know, you walk by someone, you avert your eyes, but everyone was like, hi, how are you doing? And I just didn't understand why everyone was so friendly. And it wasn't a bad thing. I honestly was very pleased with it. But when you start, your name tag actually has a little symbol on it. I've graffitied over it, but it has a little symbol, which is an acorn, which lets everyone know that you're verdant and you're green and you're new and you're not familiar with the system. And so they're kind of letting you know, just in the design of how they put your name tags together, like, everyone else come help you. Like, people would help me find the right rooms. I didn't know where the right rooms were. They'd say you had to go to room 251. I'm like, where is 251? I have no idea. Everyone really was so welcoming and helpful. So you start off that first day after the rah-rah speech going and starting to get training and calibration on your question. And the calibration happens on the second floor. It's time for you to like review the question that you're gonna be grading. In 2016, there were 7 questions, 3 long ones and 4 short ones in the pre-response. You complete the question yourself. Like I said, you review published scoring guidelines. That's what's on all the AP sites, those published scoring guidelines. And then you also get a set of what are called scoring notes, which are unpublished notes. They're kind of aimed to help you see common mistakes that students might make. And if they kind of leads them down a path where they can get points later on in a problem, how to assess those points to those problems later on. You're in a room with about 75 people, 60 to 75 people, depending on, you know, which question you're grading, whether it's a long one and a short one. And you review student samples for a day or two. And it's interesting. It really is. It gives you a new perspective on how hard some students work and what misconceptions can be easily transferred just in the way that you say it, your information about a given topic. Those student samples are culled from the work of like professionals that happen to work before the reading actually happens. They call it a pre-reading. So they take the hierarchy of the system is your readers are your grunt workers. And then above that, you have table leaders. And you sit at a table of around 7 to 10 people. And then you're table leaders kind of report to a question leader, and then your question leader reports to the chief reader, who for 2 of the 3 times that I've done it was Paul Bonvillet from Worcester in Ohio. So your calibration, you have to complete the question yourself to start. You have a few different like low stakes ways of looking at the questions and assessing how well you assess student work. And so, like I said, the long response ones were 10 points, the shorter ones are 4 points. First 2 years I was on, as 2016 and 2019, I was on 10 point questions to start. And so you have a responsibility to get the scores right because people worked hard to get to where they are. Teachers worked hard, students worked hard, a lot of money is put behind this. You do some buddy reading where you sit down with other individuals, and that's a nice way to build your PLC as well. I ended up working with a lot of cool people who I had no idea how big some of these titans in the world of AP chemistry were. I just was, you know, there and trying to keep my head above water and like sitting with Michael Farabaugh and a few other people that I was like, oh, okay, so that guy's that guy, huh? Wow. But I didn't find out until later. I probably would have been more nervous if I had known at the point. You do some of the individual reading where you like look at the test yourself and then they tell you what the amount of points should be. It's just a big room, even with 75 people, it's a crowded space and they have these big screens for you to look at and check out things. And the final step is this clicker calibration where all the professors and teachers read through a problem. You get a sense for how quickly you read versus how quickly some other people read through ideas. And you assign points and count up your points. And so like this little sample graph on the side here gives an idea. If this was supposed to get 8 and the calibration went through and they would project a picture of how many people are voting for what thing, and you wait till everyone in the room is done. Even if the one person sitting there deliberating for 5 minutes, you wait till everyone in the room is done. And they would say, all right, at this point we're calibrated and we can go back downstairs and start grading. Everyone thought this one was an 8 and it really was an 8, and only a handful of people gave some other score than what it was supposed to be. So it's like a gradual release of responsibility. The readers kind of work in this low stakes environment to start just checking out some questions and talking with each other. And then that clicker calibration thing is sort of like the high stakes part where you have to get it right. Otherwise you kind of get recalibrated. It takes a whole day for that right there. And it is really interesting. In addition to those official scoring guidelines and the unofficial note things that you, that AP kind of publishes, you also take down your own notes about if a student gets this wrong answer for part B, but they use it right in part F, here's what the answer should come out to be. And that just kind of enhances your efficiency in grading. You're making your own notes and you're putting additions to the scoring guidelines and the scoring notes. And I would always try to figure out like common math errors and how those would funnel through the process to just make it so that I could know where I was going from that, and where students could have quote wrong answers for a certain part, but actually earn points because it was consistent with what they had written before. And this actually leads into my first tip in helping your students perform well on at least the in-person AP exams. And that is, it's okay to like skip a part of the test and just make up a fake number for something. So for example, if like part B was so a problem that you didn't know how to do as a student, your student didn't know how to do, you can advise them to skip it and put some convenient number there and then use that fake number properly through the rest of the process. And if they use that fake number consistently through the rest of the process, they actually get all their points for that secondary part of it. And so you kind of expect the beginning questions to be a little easier within a certain question, the beginning sections, and then the other ones to be a little harder, but it's not always the case. Sometimes part B is a real beast and part F is like, you know, you just had to do a subtraction with the number that you had from part B. So it's okay to punt on a certain question, conjure up a number, and then just kind of move ahead and use that number for it. So it's okay to forego one portion of the free response for the benefit of another. Like if part E was worth some more points or whatever, and you couldn't do part B, but it required you to do part B, make up a fake number, plug it in and go on, and even admit that. The reader's gonna like appreciate that. I don't know how to do B. I'm pretending it's 17. Then you move forward and then you're like, okay, I gotta plug in 17 to this question matrix to know what their answer should be for part, you know, E as an example. So that's my first tip on this. And I'll put a summary slide of all the tips later on too. Don't be bashful, you're allowed to interject at any point. I know that's not the norm with these things here, but I'm happy to entertain questions and ideas at any point. Probably have to breathe and give you a chance though. After you finish up with calibration on day one, which could sputter into day two in the morning, you sit down in a room that you just sit down in a U-shaped table. You got a table leader, you got about 10 other readers around you. Your only job is to read. You have regular breaks, so all your food and blood sugar level considerations are taken care of. There are table runners that bring the folders of 20 tests in these orange folders to you. You get an in pile, an out pile. Your in pile is always larger than your out pile. And the runners are fast, they are efficient, and they bring you new questions and new stacks of student answers regularly. And you sit in this ballroom, it has dividers within it. It's a giant space. It was like the media space for the 2002 Salt Lake City Olympics. A lot of readers like to write down what their scores are. I usually count it on my fingers, but they had a tally sheet like similar to what's listed here to try to count up points. And I think it's the first day. I think it was the first day of grading, which was really day two. you having a tally sheet is helpful because if your table leader comes back and says, hey, can you look at, you know, this student ID number and say like, well, what were you thinking? How did you give this thing 8 points? What was your logic? You can kind of go through point by point and go through it. If you have any questions about it, you have a support system there. The readers, especially the first couple of days, you go and talk to your table leader and you whisper in their ear like, hey, what would you do on this thing right here? You have this whole setup in front of you of your own scoring notes, the official scoring notes, the unofficial scoring notes, and you're reading through all these to try to assess. And in the beginning, it's deliberate and slow because you want to get used to the nature of it. And as you get more into it, you get a little bit more efficient because you kind of understand what you might see and kind of see repeat things. So days 2 through 7, at least the second half of day 2 through 7, are pretty much the same. The schedule is 8 to 5. It breaks up into roughly 2 hour blocks. But there's like nice little breaks in there where you can build your PLC. And as a first year person, when you got your little acorn on there, everyone else is coming up to you and saying, hi, how are you doing? Do you have any questions? That sort of thing. I personally drank a lot of hot tea and iced tea during the process to keep myself appropriately caffeinated. I ate a lot of candy, which the tea led to a lot of bathroom breaks or whatever. But 2 hours in the morning, a couple of sessions of those, and an hour and 45, a couple of sessions in the afternoon. They structure it in a way that facilitates you being successful. 2 hours in the morning, you're a little bit fresher, you can do it. Hour 45 in the afternoon is a little more helpful. You got breaks in there to eat. I would challenge myself, like as I went through, just to get a little bit more efficient every day. My notes would be a little bit more clear. I'd have more like pathways that I could follow for a certain wrong answer. I would enhance those things as I went through the whole way and get common mathematical answers. You had your calculator with you there always because you see some kind of weird numbers once in a while and you have to address them and assess them. You have to figure out how to deal with a student like when they contradict themselves, because sometimes a part of a question will say, circle your answer here. But then they'll write more later, and when they write later, they actually contradict what they say. As you go through, you see more and more examples of these kinds of problems and how to contend with them, so you can get more and more efficient as you go through it. The table runners would yell at me frequently. There's a lot of bubble sheets that you have to fill out. Every folder, every orange folder, you get a bubble sheet in, and you have to bubble in your reader ID and your name and spell it out. And in addition to bubbling all the student scores, you had to write the numbers in for the student scores. I would frequently forget to bubble in 03416, my reader ID number, because I was so focused on making sure that I got the student value for their work right. That was what my focus was. And they'd come back to me, you didn't write your thing on there. You didn't write your thing again. By the end of it, though, that was not like my favorite number. But in order to make sure that you're doing a good job, they have this process called back reading. And what back reading is where a table leader will take a set of 20 tests that you've graded and go and score them themselves. And if they have big discrepancies in what you found and what they found, they would ask what your logic was on this. And occasionally you would bring them to a table leader and they would change how they think about it. And they would update the scoring guidelines based on what you found. And oftentimes you would count maybe 1 point too many or 1 point too low, and you'd have those discussions. So you kind of got calibrated, and those orange folders just kept coming, you know. you had to make sure you bubble your stuff, but the orange folders just kept coming. So by the end of this process, day 7, my favorite number wasn't 03416. And soon after, I did have a new favorite number. It was 62116, because like I said before, my 8.5-month pregnant wife was able to keep our son under wraps until I got home. It was about a week later that Zachary was born on the 21st of June, 6/21. So I was happy about that. It was tough to get out there. It was a challenge, but it was so worth it. So worth it that I went and did it again in 2019 when I got the next chance to do it. And I did it even this summer with the weirdness of our world currently. You do build a professional learning community. You really do. Like, I was inspired by a lot of the people in my little niche of professional learning. They do a whole heck of a lot more than I have ever done. And I'm stepping a little bit out of my comfort zone to present here, but I appreciate your attentiveness and you taking the time to listen and find out what the reading is like. I've made some really good friends through this setup here, like some strong friendships, because professionally, people who are already AP readers understand what you go through as an AP teacher, and you go through this gauntlet of being an AP reader together. It's a beautiful kind of torture. Those 15-minute breaks, you have to lean on each other sometimes to make it through the last, you know, the last hour, 45-minute segment. It's also really cool at meal times because at least in Salt Lake City, there was a whole bunch of other subjects that were also grading there. Art history, comparative government and politics, English literature and composition, studio art, U.S. government politics. They were all reading there too. And these folks were from all over the world. You had some people who were in other parts of our nation, but you've got people from Canada and South America, people who were from Asia coming to read there too. And it was really cool to see how the learning was structured in other places, how their schools were structured, how many students they had. And it helped me get a better appreciation for my own teaching situation and how I could be grateful for the things that I have. Because it's, you know, unbelievable to, you know, it's, hear about how many students are typically in a classroom in California. To me, that's like, how do you do that? That's hard to do. So you can build that professional learning community. They always have these cool outings. Like here, you're seeing a picture up from Ensign Peak. And they have different showcases in the evening where different people would present ideas and talk about like best practices. It sounds a lot like what AP Teach is trying to do, but people were bringing their one best thing and bringing it out there, and you'd walk around and talk to the people and get a handful of really great ideas and materials. So in 2016, it was a total of 52.5 hours of grading. In 2019, we did a little more than that because we actually had to go over at times because our pace wasn't quite there. And in 2020, I think I did around 40 or so hours based on the distance thing. Like the questions that I graded, I consider myself like very familiar with, but also strangely detached from. I've spent like a week grading them. And so like you could probably put an orange folder of 20 of these in me and I could probably count through and figure out what their scores were without like really, you know, engaging in my brain anymore. It becomes intrinsic to you. And it almost, when you're reading student answers to questions that you are prompting in your own setup, you have this better sense of how to assess it and how to be legit about what points should be given to it and what ones shouldn't. You really can explain, like it gives you this credibility, number one, that you've been there. And you can explain to people more easily, your students and your feedback. If you said this, you would have gotten all these points. If you had added this one sentence, it would have been full credit. So the way that the pre-response question that I read, and this is the only one I read in 2016, pre-response question two was set up, it was worth 10 points. And each subpart is not necessarily worth 1 point. Some are worth two, some are worth one. And oftentimes in a given part, you have to answer two things correct to get your 1 point, you know, like both an answer selection, what do you think will happen? Does it go up or down? And your justification for why it would be worth 1 point. And then some of the more complex part would be worth 2 points and you're going through and counting them up. So I picked out a selection of different problems and subparts that I think illustrate some ways to help enhance student responses on the AP test. So I got a list of a handful of tips. And I pulled specifically from the ones that I read to talk about some of the things that I saw. And I also pulled from Paul Bondelet's presentation from AP Teach a couple of weeks ago in the end of July. And what he had said about, you know, 10 tips from this particular year from the online distance read. Free response question two in 2016 was about mixing baking soda and vinegar. And students were asked to explain the change, at least in this subpart here. Subpart C, explain the change in terms of collisions between reactant particles. And so my first tip is to answer the question. And I know that sounds so obvious, but many students will answer a tangential question and tell me so many things that are true, good chemistry facts, but that don't connect back to what the question asks, which is in terms of collisions between reactant particles. Like I saw tons of correct chemistry ideas that just didn't specifically relate to collisions between reactant particles becoming less frequent in this particular example. As the reaction proceeds, you have fewer reactants because products are created. We all kind of get that. But if you didn't say in your answer, collisions between reactant particles, you got no points. An answer could have talked about decreasing energy or improper orientation of reactants. And they're true, you know, explanations, thoughtful explanations into why a rate could slow down. But since the question says reference in terms of collisions, you don't get any credit for that good chemistry. So this is less true for the 2020 online exam, which I think you just had to race through. But for an in-person exam, you absolutely need to take the time to read the question fully, even underline parts of it, and make sure you answer the question. And if it says, in terms of this, you start with, in terms of collisions between reactants. It's okay to restate that part right there. It just ensures that the rest of your answer flows logically and kind of keeps to the point and doesn't just hit the tangential things. My next tip is to abide by the question cues. So here's another example here. This is still from 2016. It's part D. So this question asks whether or not the specific reaction that you're considering here is entropically driven, enthalpically driven, or both entropically and enthalpically driven. And if you took the time to read through the question, you would see, okay, so it gets cooler, so it can't be enthalpically driven, but a quick scan of the chemical reaction shows that it does get less ordered. You can see an increase in entropy, and you see states of matter that are more entropic on the product side, and you can see greater numbers of moles of products there. But honestly, part D here just said circle one. So if you started to go crazy and explain why you picked what you picked, it was unnecessary. Now, in this particular problem, later on, that was something that was asked, but for here, it just says circle it. So just abide by the question cues. If it just says to circle it, pick one and circle it and move on. And that was as part of that self-challenge that I always put my, you know, self through to try to grade faster and more efficiently. Like this particular example came up, if a student contradicted themselves between the circling and the written answer and they didn't agree, we had a protocol that everyone uniformly applied to that question there. And that's just one way that you could, I could at least enhance my efficiency on this and make sure that I was being fair, accurate, consistent, and increasing my efficiency. By the third day, I knew, like, okay, if they said entropy here, but they said both entropy and enthalpy here, they wouldn't get the points. It's what they circled since it asked them to circle it. So abide by the question cues. That's a really big topic there. I did work to expand my professional network here. So this is actually a picture from 2019, and there's some other superstars of the AP chemistry world here, and I'm not gonna call anyone out in specific there, but in 2019, my experience was similar to 2016, but I knew now what to expect. I knew where the rooms were. I knew what the first kind of days were gonna be. I was a person who was now being that friendly, overly sugar sweet person to help the people who had the acorns, just to try to pay it forward. That year, 2019, I graded two questions, pre-response question two, which is one of the long ones, and pre-response question four, which is one of the shorter ones. I linked in the scoring guidelines and some student responses if you want to peek back at them afterwards, but really my point is just to talk about some specific tips. So I pulled out the specific parts and subparts that I wanted to speak about on the next slide here. In pre-response question two from 2019, students were asked to talk about the chemistry of halogens. And they were asked to reflect on an observation that might have seemed, at least initially, contrary to what they would expect. It was that something that had polar bonds within it had a lower boiling point than something that had only non-polar bonds, and it was because of the polarizability of Br2 in there. A lot of times, students will start to argue with the question prompt, like, this doesn't make sense. And that may be true, but there's a reason that they're framing the question that way. And so you can be okay with just what the question says instead of arguing the question. It's really important that you understand the difference between bonds and intermolecular forces. This has been a theme that's come up for a lot of years. I think really since the 2014 rewrite, I felt like understanding the difference between bonds and intermolecular forces is important. It sucks that hydrogen bonds are called what they are, but they are. For this particular question, I just recall students going rogue and telling me about the strength of the BrCl single bond versus the BrBr single bond. And they would be making good, accurate chemistry statements, but it wasn't answering the question. So it kind of circles back to that, make sure you answer the question, tip two thing as well. Really, understanding that bonds are not intermolecular forces is an imperative part to this. It's so easy for students to confuse intermolecular and intramolecular. So I had another example here that I think kind of cycles back to tips two and three. Again, that's make sure you answer the question and abide by the question cues. This was the second question that I read in 2019. After reading question two for probably 5 days, That question was in a good spot, but question four wasn't. So I got retrained and then kind of moved to another question. It was a shorter question. And I started grading question four on like day five of that. Now, if you look at this, it's got four parts to it. And so this is a one of those smaller point value questions, probably 4 points. You probably had 1 point per question. So the students may have had to do more than one thing per subpart A, B, C, D. I remember reading this one out of order. I actually read B, then A, C, D when I graded this. And B is the mathematical part. I felt like I got a better sense of how students were understanding it through their math to start. And then I kind of could kind of lump A and C together because A and C were both, it was both important for both A and C that the term increased was used. That was the modifier that needed to be present there. In part A, to show good understanding and answer that question, it had to use the modifier increased and attach it to motion of particles because the question is really about motion of particles. Goes back to that, make sure you answer the question thing. And in part C, the modifier increased had to be attached with frequency of collision or force of collision. So this kind of reiterates that tip three of abiding by the question cues. Make sure you re-include those ideas there that are part of the question stem, part of the question prompt. You can really derail yourself if you put more than two or three sentences for a given answer. There really shouldn't be a reason to have more than two or three sentences in a given subpart. If you're explaining more than that, you're too long-winded, maybe four on the outside chance that you want to add another point to something, but two to three sentences should be a sufficient thing to relay all the things that you want to. So 2020 happened, and this has been a year, and I imagine all of you have had some troubling, tumultuous experiences this year, and I hope everyone is safe and okay, and you know, we have to be grateful for all the things that we do have here, but the AP reading took a hit too, in my opinion. It was so different. Kids were anxious in terms of the tech, of whether they would get access properly to the test. Teachers and readers were anxious. Professors were anxious about whether or not they would be able to read properly through this thing. But in my opinion, the reader training, though not as fulfilling and rewarding because you didn't get to interact with other people, it consisted of just as many scoring opportunities and student papers that you had to give feedback through. It started out low stakes in the beginning where you're just reading through things and then it would tell you the answers. And then it got closer to that clicker training that I mentioned before where you would have to get a paper, score it, and then you wouldn't get feedback on how you did until you did a few papers. There was still back reading that happened where table leaders would go back and read things that you had looked at. And occasionally you'd get the same paper over and over again. This one paper I remembered, it was distinct because it had some diagrams on it, which is not a bad idea at times, but they were just kind of in a weird spot and didn't help. I saw this paper over and over again. I kept giving it the same score. That was a way to check my consistency and make sure that I was being fair, accurate, consistent, and efficient. But there was a lot of Zoom meetings. It was tough. I mean, all the Acorns I felt terrible for, for that to be their first experience was tough. It was harder to read in that setting, in that format. It wasn't quite as rewarding, but we did have some good Zoom meetings, some good discussion. It wasn't as much professional development that we did, but it was still good. It was still good. So my question is question C4Q1. And the way these questions were designed was to try to enhance test security. So if I was grading C4Q1 and someone else was grading C3Q1. Our questions were really similar, but with some slight modifications to alert us to the fact that someone may have been doing something nefarious in the process. Honestly, I didn't see a whole heck of a lot of tests that indicated that. The time crunch of, 25 minutes and 15 minutes to do your problems made it so that you just had to do them, and that was that. I personally found that the handwritten submissions were a little bit better than the typed ones and had more detail. What you see in the picture there is the peak efficiency that I was at one point. I was like right to start one morning. I was at more than one test per minute. I must have got a slew of ones that had really great answers, so they were easy to go through, or a slew of ones that had really terrible answers, so they were a little quicker to go through. It was different, but I got enough time to train. I got sufficient feedback from my table leaders. They're still table leaders, and you had Zoom meetings. You got a rating in terms of your pacing and in terms of your accuracy. So the things that I had been like personally tallying to challenge myself, I now had like little stars to help me decide how well I was performing. And that was, it was nice. It was a nice little touch. My next tip on this one is I think someone mentioned this during the AP Teach thing. They said, don't even bother talking about Le Chatelier's principle. But if you're going to like name check a certain phenomenon, add that one more sentence to say what that phenomenon that you're name checking is. I know that these tests are all out there and that you can and look at them through your own portal, the way that the students are set up with. But I'm pretty sure AP is kind of holding these tight to the vest in some respects as well. But I know I graded a question where if you just said common ion effect, you got nothing. But if you said common ion effect and then explained what it was, you got everything. And so I think that was probably a point where a lot of the students who you were like, man, this kid is getting a 4, and then they got a 3. This is where one of those places where they were dinged in that sort of way. There was a ton of agree disagree questions, but honestly, the agree disagree part was less important. A student could fumble around and disagree inappropriately, but with good explanation afterwards, and still earn all of the credit. So if we are distance again, I would put a big push behind that thinking of claim evidence reasoning, where you answer the question in your claim, and then you pull from the given graphs or your own understanding or the given tables for your evidence, and then you use one more sentence of reasoning to tether together the claim and the evidence. So you're getting 2 to 3 sentences, maybe on an outside chance 4 to cinch everything all together. And that's all you need to answer those questions. So a lot of those agree-disagree ones, the kids could have disagreed inappropriately and earned all their credit if their logic and their explanation afterwards made more sense than what they said at the beginning about disagreeing. They weren't fully invalidated right at the beginning with this. And I think that was partially because of the shorter test. We had to have a way to distinguish students at different levels and partially just out of humanity on the part of the test system and the graders and the leaders. These kids were put under immense pressure, and this is a totally weird situation. So it's not fair to ding them for just the way our world is right now. If some kid is showing you something good, give them credit for showing you something good. So I put a big push behind that claim evidence reasoning method as a way to frame your answers for those lettered subparts of the free response question. My last tip, be careful with net ionic equations. This one killed me on this test this year, because I saw something not quite like CaCl2 breaking up into Ca2 plus ions and 2Cl minus ions, but something really very similar to it. And if you had all your charges and the stoichiometric set up there properly, you got all your credit. And that was potentially 2 points. And if you missed the charge on something, or you missed the stoichiometric value to balance out your ions, you got none of your credit. And that was tough to me. And I think this is another place where maybe those kids who you were like, this kid's getting a 5, dropped down to a 4, unfortunately. You know, a little error on the top equation where you omit the 2 charge on calcium, to me, in my opinion, shouldn't have invalidated it. But the way that the guidelines were set up, it invalidated the whole thing. Those other ones on the bottom, they're more erroneous. They're showing you like some bigger misconceptions or some bigger omissions of understanding. So for this last tip about being careful with your net ionic equations, I kind of have a suggestion. It's something that I've done a lot in the past with when we were in person. I broke my class into 2 groups, made them make solutions of different materials. One of the solutions was a hydrated crystal, so it was a little harder for them to do some of the calculations. This would be in like the first month and a half of school. The second one was a solution that actually is impossible to make at the concentration that I assigned it. And then I asked them to mix the 2 together, and it made it precipitate. And then at each step along the way, we were drawing particulate diagrams and trying to write out equations. And then throughout the whole rest of the year, I could refer back to that. Hey, do you remember times that you guys made solutions? And they had to like practice their techniques of solution making. They had to practice their techniques of writing equations. They had to practice their techniques of, well, which thing is going to be in soluble precipitation. And they were drawing lots of good particulate diagrams to hit the Johnstone triangle pieces that we were talking a little bit before about the AP Teach in the previous meeting. Something like that, or even just a demonstration if we're in a distance format where you ask them to help you make it, and you're maybe in your room and building based on their own experience, and then you ask them to draw the models and kind of collaborate with that. It'll take longer in distance format, but it was just, for me, it's something that I always lean back on as a good experience for the students and something to lean back on to help them really understand and get a better understanding for net ionic equations. So here's a summary of the tips that I have thrown out there as ones to get better scores. You know, it's okay to punt on a problem. That's tip one. If you have to make sure you answer the question. I know it sounds self-explanatory, but just don't reference related ideas. Answer the question. If it says, how high will you jump? Say, I will jump this high. If the question is saying you to do something like circle something, just do that and don't go further than that. Save your time for other stuff instead. It's more valuable to answer your other pieces to things. Get a real good understanding of the difference between bonds and intermolecular forces. If you just name check a principle, you're probably not going to get your points. So just give that one extra sentence to define what it is. And then finally, make sure you're good on you're writing your balanced net ionic equations with all the charges and the stoichiometric coefficients. If you missed some of that, it was tough. I felt like it really dinged some people who otherwise showed a great lot of understanding. And if you take a peek, this is something that Paul Bondelet put out, his top 10 suggestions, and a few of them match up really well with some of the ones that I put up there. So there's the source of where it came from on the bottom, but when you're writing to be understood, that's all about claim evidence reasoning. We talked a lot about one of my tips, I think number 6 it was, intermolecular forces. Look out for the cues in the question and make sure you just answer it. The net ionic equation is another one that came up there. I disagree with number 9 in some respects when it says, show your work. Show your work to a degree that lets a reader know what you are doing and moving from one step to the next. But if you go too in depth and you go more than just the claim evidence reasoning, you're actually going to hurt yourself and you're going to make it so that you're wasting time on one problem that you probably have already earned your points on and taking that time from another problem that you could be earning points on. The other points here, I agree with what he said here, the other 10 points or the other 9 points besides number 9, I think make a whole heck of a lot of sense and really followed through in the question that I was grading. And I only graded one question the whole time through. I graded about 1,200 exams in that time frame. So yeah, it was a lot, but it was awesome. It was. Both in person and in a distance format, I would encourage you to become an AP reader because it is like the best professional development out there. In person is a little more fun than in the digital format, but you get to build your professional learning community. You get to see how the questions are graded. You get to have that credibility immediately attached to your name because you know how things should be set up. It makes you a better and more efficient grader in your own practice. At first I was frustrated, like, why can't I become an AP reader back in 2008 when I first started? So my district was awesome and they sent me to a conference in a local private school to get used to the, you know, AP chemistry rigors and understand what it was. It was like a 2-week course and I think it was tough, but I wanted then to become an AP reader. I actually had more time. I didn't have any kids at that point and I would have been able to do it, but I wasn't ready. Until you teach it for a few years, you're not ready. So you put your name in and they kind of keep you in the hopper for a couple of years. And that's not to be mean. It's just to, okay, now I know you want to. So the next time, you know, we have a spot, they'll put you in and they bring in new readers. They bring back old readers. I really did need to wait a couple of years before I was ready for it. But I would absolutely speak highly to this experience and encourage anyone to do it. Even with the challenges that I set forth here, it was totally worth it. And it is totally worth it. I would continue to do it in the future. I thank you so much for your time and attention. And we should have about 15 minutes left to address any questions that people have. There's my Twitter handle and email account, which you're welcome to contact me at any time with questions or thoughts about this. And I'm happy to share more about it or answer any questions that you have about the process of becoming an AP reader. So thank you, everybody.
Can you speak to how long it took from the time you applied to the time you first were able to read, just in the sense, like, I know I've taught it for 7-8 years, but I'd never applied because I had kids right after I started teaching it. So it was like, I have babies, I can't go. And now that my kids are a little bit older, it's I'm hesitant to apply only because it's like, am I going to get called right now because I've taught it, or am I, you know, am I going to probably have to leave too, and I'll have time to kind of prep.
So Aaron, I would absolutely say apply now. If they ask you to come and you can't for a given reason in a certain year, just say that you can't, and they give you options to select as to why you can't go. And if you pick the ones that like make sense, like, oh, I will be able to go in the future, but this year I can't, they'll let you go back. If you start saying no two or three times in a row, they might not let you go back as well. But like, I would, if you 7-8 years, you've taught it, you have your feet under you, it is a super valuable experience. I would apply now and just, you know, let it be out there that you are willing to do it, interested in doing it. Took me 2 years to get from when I applied to it to when I actually got it. And I think it was helped by some of the other work that I do at, like, you know, UConn, some of the college stuff that I teach too, because I was, you know, sort of also high school and also that. So that 2-year turnaround might not be the same. It might take a few years. I know some people are like, I applied 4 years ago and I still haven't been asked. Eventually they will ask you. They want new people to come in so that everyone can get a chance to do it. And it really is awesome. It's an awesome experience.
Thanks.
You're welcome. So
I was letting other people ask questions. I have two. in the AP reading for the environmental science, you really just kind of go to your 10 points, and once the kid gets there, you don't read the other nonsense that's beyond that. Do they do that for the chemistry one too?
Not exactly. Because the questions are subdivided into those lettered pieces, you end up reading all the things, and a kid can sabotage themselves if they say something terribly erroneous, where you read the first half of what they're saying and it's like, yeah, that's awesome. You totally got all your points. You're like, whoa, 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 wait a minute. And that's kind of where I really fall in favor of using that claim evidence response system, because it holds you to that 2 to 3 to maybe 4 sentences, and you risk having the chance of saying that terrible thing that has gonna lose you points, you know, instead of just saying what you need to say and getting your points.
Gotcha. And then I don't know what should people expect for their district in terms of being cooperative, in terms of either paying you, or do you give your honorarium back to the school?
It's all over the place. So from the East Coast, it's tough to go. It's the beginning of June and you're still technically teaching. Maybe it's your exam time or maybe it's your review time. But I know that other places, some private schools actually pay the teachers more to go and do it because it's such a feather in their cap. So there's actually, it depends on what your situation is. When you approach your district about doing something like this, you have to be delicate because it is a fair bit of time away from the classroom, and you have to, you know, lean on your colleagues to make sure that things are running smoothly in your own class. And there are other considerations, but you can come back with some great experience, and, just the brand name of being an AP reader has value to it. You know, it has some esteem associated with it. And so you can play that up. AP is good about providing you with materials to open up that discussion with your district. So they have some things like, well, here's an intro letter of what it's going to be like, so you can understand it. I think the biggest surprise to me the first time I did it was that I was like advertising to the principal, like, oh, don't worry, I'll be gone for 7 days. Nope, it was 9 days. You know, it was tough. It was challenging to a day to get out there. And for the first time, that was a Sunday that was out there, so it wasn't a big deal. But, you know, it was an extra day on the end of travel when all the arrangements started being put through. And some districts are really, really supportive. That's one of the click boxes that they give you in the accept or decline your invitation, because you can decline your invitation right away if you know you can't do it. But if you If you do decline it, one of the things it says, my district is not supportive of it, and you can put a little blurb, I'm interested in doing it in the future. I'm just going to have to work to convince my district of why this is valuable and what it is and what kind of goodness can be garnered from it. So it runs the whole gamut. It's everywhere.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Morgan, if your district did make you give it back, mine attempted to do that, make sure that you subtract out your weekends and that you subtract out your taxes, because AP won't cut that check to your district. They'll only cut it to you. And so by the time you subtract most of that out, you're not making much money. The reality.
That was my understanding too.
Yeah. it's not really for the money. There's a little bit there, but it's really for the experience more than anything. You get to a little bit of traveling under normal circumstances, non-2020 circumstances. And you're absolutely right, Susan. It's not, you're not getting your palm greased on this one. It's not happening that way. You get fed well, you get treated well, you do a lot of reading, but you're not getting paid a terrible amount. I think the stipend before taxes is $1,700. And then after taxes, take a few hundred off of that. But if you can assume that you're still being paid by your district and you can overlap, you know, both being paid by your district and that little extra bit, it's more tolerable. Thank you for asking that question. That's a tough question. The financial bit of it is, it's tough because it's a lot of days away. It is. My wife is a saint to have. Last year we had 1, 3, and 5-year-old when I went in 2019. So I got my my plane tickets for the latest possible time. So I was gone for the least amount of time and returned at I left. The reading ended at 5 and I ate dinner and left at 11, which is what, you know, time I could get to the airport in time for. So I was saying bye to people, you know, pulling my suitcase. So thank you, everyone. If you have any other questions that crop up and you're interested in finding out more about what it's like to become an AP reader, let me know. Shoot me an email. I'm happy to speak highly to it, the beautiful torture that it is. Enjoy your break and your next meetings.
Thank you. Great. That went well.
I thought it went okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, thanks for sharing the
experience. Hey guys, sorry.
Hi, Chris.
I had a tech support issue that came up.
Yeah. Sounds about right. Right.
So, all right. But all the parts of your presentation I got to watch, Brandon, were really good.
I'm glad you got to see some of it. And I'm happy to answer questions if you have follow-ups afterwards based on the ones you didn't get to see.
I really appreciate it. I got about half of it, and then I was watching you while I was doing we got somebody locked out of the meeting, and I don't know that how.
You want me to log them out, or I don't know who?
Oh, well, yeah, that's the whole thing. I did the first rule of tech support, turn it off and turn it back on again.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So, unfortunately, I got to end this meeting to go to the next one.
Yep, makes sense.
All right.
Hey, Chris, reach out if you need anything, right?
Awesome.
Thanks, Chris. Thank you, Morgan. You did great.
Yep. Take care. Yes. Peace, guys.